Happy Valentine's Day, everybody, and welcome to Online Church. My name is John, and like every week, we are delighted to have you joining us today at the Englewood Assembly of God. If you're just popping in, why don't you leave us a comment telling us who you're watching with and where you're watching from? Or if you've got something more personal and serious that you'd like to share with us, you can leave that in the comments too, or you can message us privately, either through social media or our website, www.eagrm.org. Just drop us a line and we'll get in touch with you right away. Now the service is just about ready to start, so let's grab a Bible in one hand, some of those edible chalk hearts in the other, if you like those, and let's get ready for another great weekend of online church.
Table for us, the crucified Jesus, no greater love than the bread your body, than the wine your blood.
Here we are on a Sunday, and this particular Sunday this year happens to be Valentine's Day, and so it's not a Christian holiday, but it's always a good opportunity to talk about love. In fact, every message that ever could be preached has to have God's love as part of the theme. But just taking you through a little bit here, according to businesses, Valentine's Day is the third biggest day of the year for buying gifts. Christmas is first, Mother's Day is second. I'm not sure where Father's Day made the list, but when it comes to candy, flowers, cards, Valentine's Day slips in right behind Christmas. If today is like Valentine's Days of the past, over 1 billion will be spent on chocolate, 180 million cards will be exchanged, 196 million roses will be sold. Listen to what these kids ages 4 to 8 said about love. Love is when a girl puts on perfume and a boy puts on cologne and they go out and smell each other. Love is when my mommy makes coffee for my daddy and she takes a sip before giving it to him to make sure it's just right. Love is when you tell a guy you like his shirt, then he wears it every day. I know my older sister loves me because she gives me all of her old clothes and she has to go out and buy new ones. When you love somebody, your eyelashes go up and down and little stars come out of you. Well, I'm not sure about that girl. A little boy asked his father, "Daddy, how much does it cost to get married?" He said, "I'm not sure, son. I'm still paying for it." Someone has said that marriage is when you agree to spend the rest of your life sleeping in a room that is too hot beside someone who is sleeping in a room that's too cold. A Bible college student wanted to impress his girlfriend's father. He wrote him a letter and shared his testimony of how he became a Christian. He closed the letter, asking for the father's permission to date his daughter. He signed his name and then added the reference of one of his life verses. And that life verse was 1 Samuel 12:24, which says, "But be sure to fear the Lord and serve him faithfully with all your heart. Consider what great things he has done for you." In his nervousness, however, he wrote the reference for 2 Samuel 12:24 instead of 1 Samuel. The father was greatly surprised when he looked up the reference that says, "Then David comforted his wife Bathsheba, and he went to her and lay with her. She gave birth to a son, and they named him Solomon." Well, the young man certainly made an impression on his girlfriend's father, but not the impression he wanted. A couple was arranging for their wedding and asked the bakery to decorate their wedding cake with the words from 1 John 4:18, which reads, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear." The bakery evidently lost, smudged, or otherwise misread the note, and they beautifully inscribed on the cake John 4:18 instead of 1 John 4:18. But what they put on the cake was, "For you have had five husbands, and the man you have now is not your husband." Well, the moral of these stories is be careful how you write out your Bible verses. This really resonates this morning with me because just before we started recording this message, John reminded me that I had a couple references that were wrong. So that can happen to the best of us. I like what legendary football coach Vince Lombardi, when he gave a speech one time about developing winning teams, and he was certainly a winner. He said there are a lot of coaches with good ball clubs who know the fundamentals of football and have a lot of discipline, but they still don't win the games and they don't win the big games. He said there is a third ingredient. If you're going to play together as a team, you've got to care for one another. The difference between mediocrity and greatness, said Lombardi, is the love these guys have for each other. John 13, 34 and 35 says, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." The problem is that too many people get their understanding of love nowadays and in the past as well from not from God's word, but from maybe some of those old love songs they listened to or what they saw in their parents. You know, like popular music tells us, you can't stop that love and feeling, or love will keep us together. One man said, "When I think of a great love, I think of my grandparents who were married in February of 1933, which by all accounts was a pretty tough year to start a life together." He said, "I'm not sure that my grandparents ever really knew when the Depression was over because life was always hard for them. They didn't even have indoor plumbing until the 1970s. But they managed to raise four daughters, including my mother," this guy says, "and claim 13 grandchildren and who knows how many great-grandchildren as their greatest possession. Unlike many of their generation, my grandparents were not shy about demonstrating their love for one another. They held hands, they flirted, and Grandpa would not pass by Grandma without giving a little kiss on the cheek. You could have written a love song about my parents, my grandparents. Maybe that's what the Beatles had in mind when they sang 'All You Need Is Love,' because they didn't have much else." This guy goes on to say that one of his aunts had a much different story. She quit high school to marry a young punk who was already on his way to becoming a drunk and a drug addict. She had two babies before she was 19, and for the next 10 years, she lived in mortal fear of the man who would beat her and beat the children. She might have sung like Tina Turner, "What's Love Got to Do with It?" Or "Love is Nothing But a Secondhand Emotion." And it makes me think sometimes that for every song about falling in love, there are about two about the heartaches of broken love. In real life, a lot of people find themselves either mildly disappointed or downright upset that love is not all it's cracked up to be, at least the love as they thought and what they look for. In her book, The Heart of a Mother, Ruby Johnson wrote about two kinds of love, because love and in spite of love. She says, "After our honeymoon, we discovered traits in one another that disturbed us. In answer to prayer, we learned how to change our course. We discovered that marriage needed another kind of love in spite of love. That kind of love is unselfish. Because love, or selfish love, says he's handsome, therefore he makes me feel proud. He is kind, therefore he will comfort me. He is reliable, therefore he will give me security. But the in spite of love is different. It says he is careless, therefore even though it will make more work for me, I will try to compensate for his weakness and patiently endure. He is moody, and that disturbs my peace of mind, but I will do my best to help him cultivate a better mood. He is a spendthrift and makes me feel insecure, but I will try to understand his generous spirit and charitable nature. In spite of love is a nice notion, but is that kind of love even possible? Because most of us grew up with love that was conditional. If you're a good boy or girl, then mom and dad, you know, liked you. Your teachers, you know, cared about you. If you're physically attractive, you gained some guy's attention. If you had some tangible evidence of success, then you kept some girl's interest. But if you slipped up or gained a few pounds or put on a few wrinkles or lost your job or otherwise just became human, then for some people in that conditional, that love slips away. We know that love is one of the most ambiguous words in the English language. People say things like, I love pizza, I love football, I love my wife, I love the Lord. Same word. But fortunately, the Bible was written in the Greek language, and the Greeks were very much more descriptive. There were four words that they had for love. And let me tell you about three of those real quickly. Phileo means a friendship love. Hence, we get the words like Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love, or philanthropist, who gives generously to the causes he or she loves. Phileo love is based on the fact that I'll be your friend as long as you'll be my friend. Eros is sensual love, the love of passion, a love that fulfills the senses. It is the base of our English word erotic. So it encompasses sexual love. Eros love is selfish. It's about, you know, my needs being met. And that's in various different ways, not just with sex. But there's another kind of love, the greatest kind of love, that the New Testament talks about in great detail. And it's agape love. It is a word that means unconditional love. It's not dependent upon what you can give back to somebody or what you give or what you receive or about feelings of self-gratification. Agape love is perfect God love, that God loves us because God is love. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world," agape, "the world he gave his only son, and that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." 1 John 3:1 says, "How great is the love," the agape love, "the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are." In Jeremiah 31, God said, "I have loved you with an everlasting love." And then we get to some of Paul's writings like Romans 8, 35 through 39. And he talks about this amazing agape love. And he said, "Who shall separate us from the agape of Christ, the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who," guess what, "loved us. For I am convinced that neither life nor death, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any power, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation," in other words, nothing, "will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Let me just say that this love is not a mushy, gushy, sentimental, sappy love. This kind of love is a verb. It's love is an action. And Romans 5:8 says, "But God demonstrated," you know, that's action, "he demonstrated his own love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." And then 1 John 3 says, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth. Now, with these thoughts of love that I've just kind of talked about, marital love and relationship love, and certainly the love that God has for us, what I want to talk to you about today is, how is your love life? And in fact, that's the title of this message, you know, about a Christian's love life. Now, we think about our love life, especially around Valentine's Day, and some people say, man, you know, my love life is awesome. Others might say, my love life is non-existent, or it's not very good. I heard about one couple that had been married for a while. Things were not going well. They were on hard financial times, and the wife was arrested for shoplifting. She went before the judge with her husband, and the judge said to her, you're arrested for shoplifting. He said, tell me about it. She said, I stole a can of peaches. He said, why did you steal a can of peaches? She said, I was hungry. He said, how many peaches were in the can? She said, six. He said, six peaches, that's 6 days in jail. And just before he could wrap his gavel, the husband stood up and said, Your Honor, I've got something else to say. And he said, what's that? She also stole a can of peas. Well, not much love in that marriage. But yet that's not what the Bible tells us, the kind of love that we can have. So you and I have got to have the right kind of love to grow as a Christian. So I'd like to speak to you about the Christian's love life. And I want to use the verses from 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. So let me just read these in two different translations, and then I want to pray, and then we're going to launch in to the Christian's love life. 1 John 2, verse 15. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever. That's in the NIV. Listen to those verses again in the New Living Translation. It gives a little bit more contemporary clarity. It says, do not love this world nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything that we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from the world. And this world is fading away along with everything that people crave. But anyone who does what pleases God will live forever. Would you pray with me for just a moment? Father, this is your holy word. Lord, it is a love letter to every one of us. It's a personal love letter that tells us about your love for us, the love that Jesus has for us, the love that we are to have for one another, the love that we are to have for a broken world and our hurting folks, Lord, the love that we should even have for enemies. God, it's an amazing love that we need to have, and we need to build on it. Speak to us today about this love. And Lord, let us not just hear this message and make comments about it in our mind thinking, but Lord, that we will let it come into our hearts and change us and transform us into the people that we need to be. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, John says that he's writing this portion of the Word of God to give assurance. He wants to help us to know that we know that we know that we are children of God. In fact, you know, John does this when he writes. So he's writing to us saying that if a person loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. In other words, to be a Christian means you've got to have the right kind of love life. Now, the Bible here talks about two worlds, the world of the spirit and the world of the flesh. You cannot be in love with this world and be in love with Jesus at the same time. A lot of people try to ride the fence. They're like the fellow in the Civil War who wore a blue shirt and gray trousers, and both sides were shooting at him. So it's impossible to straddle the fence. A lot of Christians have just enough religion to make them miserable. They don't really serve the Lord, and they're afraid to really live for the devil. They're just mushy in the middle. Jesus said you've got to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. All of us, you know, with all that is in us, we're to love God. John says that if you love the wrong world, you're not going to have fullness of joy. If in your life there is a lack of peace, a lack of purpose, then it's an indication that you have the right kind of love life, that you're in love with this world and not with the Lord, that you don't have the right kind of love life. But we can have that. If I see a person that is in love with the things of this world and acts like this world and talks like this world and lives like this world, then I've got to conclude that person loves the world And John says, love not the world. Now, what does he mean when he says world, by the way? Well, he's not talking about the world of nature. He's not saying that we shouldn't love a beautiful sunset or being to the mountains or going to the ocean. He's not talking about that we should not love the wonderful things that God has made, because God has made a beautiful world. He's given us those things to enjoy. He's not saying don't love the world of nature. He's not saying don't love the world of humanity. The Bible says that God himself loved the world of humanity, if you will, that he sent his only begotten son. Well, somebody has well said that if we love the world as God loves the world, then we would not love the world as we should not love the world. So the word world comes from the Greek word cosmos, which means to arrange. And so when we talk about the world of sports, we're talking about the system or arrangement of the things revolved around, you know, sports personalities, sporting events. So when John says love not the world, he means do not love the world system. Don't love this arrangement of things that the world has going that opposes God. And so I think we all understand that. In 2 Corinthians 4:4, it says, the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not. John 12:31 says, now is the judgment of this world, now is the prince of this world cast out. We're talking about Satan, devil, the evil one, if you will. This world has got the kind of wisdom that makes something legal like alcohol, and when a man gets drunk, they put him in jail. The kind of wisdom this world has is to take the Bible out of the hands of a school child. At least in America, that's how it is. But when that child gets in trouble and goes to jail, the first thing they give him is a Bible. It's backwards. And that's the way the wisdom of the world is. It's a system that's anti-God. It's anti-Christ. And the Bible says it is this world that rejected Jesus. It's this world system that put him on a cross. And so we either love this world that rejected the Son of God, or we love Jesus and we love the things of God. So with that definition in mind, what does it mean to be worldly? Well, let me just tell you that anything that stands between you and your relationship to Jesus, anything that hinders your spiritual growth, anything that keeps you from being the Christian that you want to be, and anything that is opposed to the Word of God, anything that stands between you and your love for Jesus, you know, it's of this world, and we should stay away from it. Now, that doesn't mean all those things might be evil or bad in themselves, but they're keeping us from loving Christ. Every day that you live, you're in a battle, and you need to decide which side you're going to be on. Notice what the world uses. 1 John 2:16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, those are the three pressures that the world puts on you and I to hinder our spiritual growth, to keep us from loving Jesus like we should. So I want to talk about those, because we got to get this in right understanding if our love life is going to be what it should be. First, there's the lust of the flesh. That is an appeal to our body. Satan, this world system, will use our body to draw us away from God. God made us so that we desire food. That's a good thing. But when you live to eat instead of eating to live, and you eat to the point where you abuse your physical body, you're caught up in the wrong game. That's worldliness. God created sex and said it was good, but the devil and the world will use that powerful sex drive that we have to lead us to a shortcut and to lead us away from the marital type of love or the type of love that we should have for brothers and sisters in Christ, and we get out of bounds with it. Secondly, he talks about the appeal to the mind, the lust of the eyes, because everything that comes into our mind comes through the door of our eyes. That's why Job said, I have made a covenant with my eyes that I will not sin against the Lord. And so we've got to make that same covenant with our eyes, because the devil is going to use what we see to draw us away from the things of God. Many people, you know, get drawn off the path because Satan somehow captures their mind. I believe that when King David walked on his roof garden and looked over the rooftop at Bathsheba when she's taking a bath, I think David looked at her and kept looking at her until the devil had so captured his mind with lust that it led to adultery, it led to having her husband murdered, and it started as he looked. The lust of the eyes, seeing something, taking your eyes off of God and looking at that thing, whether it's sexual or something else, and saying, I want it and I want it now. I need it in my life. When Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, the Bible tells how Satan captured Eve's mind. When the woman saw that the fruit was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes, that's when she sinned. So we got to make a covenant with our eyes. We got to keep our eyes on Jesus. So first, there's an appeal to the body. Then there's an appeal to the mind. And third, there's an appeal to our spirit. The Bible calls it the pride of life. The pride of life is that which makes you feel you must do certain things or meet certain standards to be accepted by this world system. It is thinking that you have to, you know, take drugs so you'll be accepted in the group. Or it's thinking you've got to drink socially for business reasons to be accepted in that group. The pride of life is doing things that are really against our conviction as Christians, but we do them to be accepted by that same world system that crucified Christ. I've got to have this type of house. I've got to drive this type of car. I've got to get this certain degree from this prestigious university. That pressure to be accepted by the world is the pride of life, and it leads us to love the things of this world more than loving Jesus. We got to understand that the devil is going to appeal to our body. He's going to appeal to our mind. He's going to appeal to our spirit. Why? To draw us off that path of being in love with Jesus. Now listen, this is no mystery. It happens in our married life. You know, we do all that we can to love that person, you know, so that we get to that point of marriage, we get married, and then sometimes if we're careful, we forget to keep, you know, stirring up that love that we should have one for another, and we go our own ways. The wife maybe is busy taking care of the kids, the husband's climbing up the corporate ladder, and we can find ourselves growing apart. How many people do you hear that get divorced, you know, after they've been married 20, 25, 30 years, because all those years of being busy making, you know, the family work, they forgot to stoke the fires of their own romantic love. Well, it can happen in our Christian life. Christians, we can get busy, you know, doing things for God that we forget to cultivate our relationship with Him. Now, here's how it happens, how we get drawn away. First, we become friendly with the world. James 4:4 says, whoever therefore will be a friend to the world is the enemy of God. Secondly, we become spoiled by the world. Just like wearing a white coat into a coal mine is going to rub off on you, and you're going to get spotted by the world. We think, well, it won't happen to us, that we're going to be okay. Thirdly, we become conformed to this world. And that's why Romans 12:2 tells us, do not be conformed to this world. And conform means be pressed into a mold. So we cannot let the world squeeze us into its mold. Listen, Christian brother and sister, it's okay to be different at work. It's okay because you're a Christian to be different at school. The world is going to be intimidated by you because they can't stand anybody who has different morality, different values, different way of living. They're intimidated by that, but eventually, I believe, if you keep living your Christian life as you should, they'll be convicted by that and want to have the same life you have. The danger is when we get conformed to this world, we'll be condemned by this world. You say it can't happen to me. Yes, it can. It could happen to any one of us. The Bible says there was a man named Demas, D-E-M-A-S. He was the assistant of the Apostle Paul. Can you imagine that, being an assistant to the Apostle Paul and all the amazing things that he did? Yet Paul writes in 2 Timothy, Demas left us. He has forsaken us, having loved this present world. There we go again. Here's a guy that knew to love God with all of his heart, soul, mind, and strength, but yet, even working with Paul, he found himself more and more moving to loving this world. I guess one day Demas, he probably resigned his Sunday school class. Then I think he just neglected the Bible and he neglected his prayer life. And pretty soon he was going out of town most every weekend so that he wouldn't even have to be face the thought of should he go to church or not. And pretty soon he's backslidden. And his story is in the Word of God for us for a reason. So that we won't do the same thing, so that we will not love this world, because loving this world means we've moved away from the love of the Father. I think in the Old Testament of a guy named Lot. He was a child of God, yet he pitched his tent towards Sodom. And that is a magnificent scripture that when he chose the land he did and Abraham went his way, the Bible says Lot pitched his tent toward or literally facing Sodom, which means every day he'd get up in the morning, guess what he saw? Sodom. He'd see the smoke coming from their fires. He would hear the laughter and the activities coming from there at night. And then after that, we don't hear anything about Lot for a few chapters in the book of Genesis. And the next time we read about Lot, guess what? He is in the city of Sodom, a city that God is about to destroy because of their wickedness. How did it start? He just began to look at it. But friends, the good news is that the Bible teaches that every one of us can be victorious. Every one of us can have the love life in the order that it should be. Every one of us can have victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil. And this verse, the very last verse that I read in 1 John here, tells us how to have it. First, you've got to realize the passing nature of this world. For the world and the lust thereof will pass away. The Bible says that pleasure of sin is only for a season. It might feel fun, it might seem right, but it's going to come to an end. The devil cannot give you everything that you want and everything that will last, because sin does not last. You're going to come up disappointed. You're going to be empty. Secondly, you need to realize that this verse says the permanent nature of those who do the will of God. The verse ends by saying, he that does the will of God abides forever. So listen, do you want to do something that will last for eternity? Then be a Christian father. Be a Christian husband. Be a Christian wife and mother. Be a Christian young person. Love the Lord Jesus Christ with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and strength. See, the Bible is clear about God's love for us. That's not an issue. I mean, it's all written through the page, and I gave you many scriptures today. God loves us. But how is our love towards him? That's the question today. Is the world leading you astray? Jesus warned, by the way, that in the last days, the love of many would grow cold. So how is your love life for the Lord today? If it's not where it should be, it can be. You can begin that step and get your eyes back on the Lord. Get the focus of your life back on Jesus. Begin doing those things. You know, Revelation talks to one of the churches about how they had lost their first love. You can go read about that in Revelation chapter 3 and get that first love in your life back. Father, I pray that that will be the case for those today that maybe have got busy with life, or they got negligent in their Christian disciplines. Lord, that we can get to that place where we are in love with you. God, that we wake up every morning declaring, this is the day the Lord has made. My Lord, my Savior, who loves me, that I love, he's made this day, and I'm going to rejoice and I'm going to be glad in it because he's here with me and I'm following his will. And it's going to be an awesome day because he's in charge of it and I'm in love with him. Father, I pray there's anyone here today that doesn't feel that, that doesn't know that, that you'll draw them back to yourself. Lord, that they can have victory over this world, that they can have the glorious life that you've meant for us to have, an abundant life. We thank you that it's your desire to give it to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great day.
Well, one more time, thank you so much for spending your Sunday morning with us. If you would like to find out more about the Englewood Assembly of God, who we are and what we do, be sure to check out these social media links down below. You can also go to our website, www.ehgrm.org. We would love to touch base with you and get you connected with our church family. That's all the time we've got for this week, but be sure to join us again same place, same time next week as we come back together for another weekend of online church. We look forward to having you join us, and so until we see each other again, stay safe, take care, and God bless. Happy Valentine's Day!